which is called Worthy of Trust? Question mark. Law, ethics, and culture in banking. Thank you, everybody, for coming this morning. I'd like to introduce, if in any introduction is needed, our distinguished panel. Governor Mark Carney. Mark, thank you very much for your hospitality here at the bank this morning. President Dudley of the New York Fed. Bill, thank you so much for coming and joining us this morning. As I said earlier this morning, we, as you know, attach the utmost importance to our links with the United States and with the authorities in the United States, so we are particularly glad to see you here. Our third panel member is the Lord Chief Justice, Lord Thomas. And John, I am extremely grateful also that you have agreed to come and join this panel to give us an unusual and new perspective on the issues we are talking about this morning. The format's going to be that we will make some, I will make some short introductory remarks. Each of our panelists will then speak for about 10 minutes or so, and then we will throw it open for questions, comments, all sorts of interchange. What I hope will be a debate. The purpose of this morning is for us to have a debate about these issues, and I'm very much hoping that we will. I'm going to begin with a statement of what might seem like the glaringly obvious, which is this. What happens in the banking sector is of the utmost importance to all of us as economic actors, as private individuals, and as citizens, and not just as citizens of one country. The interconnected global banking sector means that no one and nowhere is immune from what happens in this sector. We had a very sharp lesson on this in the global financial crisis of 2008, and failures of several different kinds in several different parts of the banking sector have continued to happen since then. What we're here to share today is our collective thinking on ways we are aiming to understand and shape the changing dynamics of this most important economic sector. To understand how the institutions of law and regulation can support the positive development and deter wrongdoing. And to understand how those who are responsible for the leadership of firms in the banking sector can determine and deliver a good culture in these businesses. But most of all, the purpose of today, certainly my purpose, is to take us back to some basics. What is the purpose of the banking sector? Is the very notion of a bank changing radically in the light of technological change? How can a bank operate sustainably? And I don't mean by that, what does it do about recycling its coffee cups? Although that's important. I mean, how does it ensure that it operates in a way that means it is going to survive for the long term? Does a bank understand the needs of its customers, and does it aim to satisfy them? Again, this might seem like a fairly obvious question, but it's one that needs asking. And how do the ultimate owners of banks aim, if at all, to influence what happens on them? And I know that some of those ultimate owners, people from the asset management industry, are here today, and it would be great to hear from you. Now, the Banking Standards Board, which is a non-statutory body, is working to support all of those whose responsibility it is to determine what happens in a culture of banks and building societies. This responsibility lies fair and square with the boards and senior executives of these organisations. Yes, this is a heavily regulated sector, but regulation can't determine how an organisation operates any more than can the law determine how it operates. Of course, firms have got to comply with regulation under law, but you'd be foolish indeed as a senior executive or a board member of a bank or indeed a building society to think that that was the beginning and end of your responsibilities. So we're at the BBC, the BSB, sorry. Was that a Freudian slip? I wonder. I don't know whether we've got any colleagues here from the BBC today. Thank you. I didn't mean BBC, okay, delete that from the record. Right, I'll start that again. We at the BSB are working to support the leaders of this sector in establishing and developing what good cultures might be in their businesses. There isn't any one good culture, but we believe that any good culture will have some core characteristics. These include responsiveness, accountability, personal resilience, and openness. Our recently published review suggests that these are all areas where, looking across this sector, some progress needs to be made. Firms need to speak honestly, they need to speak bravely about what they need to do, what they are doing, why they're doing it, and importantly, how they're going to know if they're succeeding. And they need to do this, not just round the board table or in senior executive meetings, but they need to have this conversation with everyone in the firm. And everyone in the firm needs to be able to see that board members and executives live up to what they say they are trying to do. Actions speak louder than words, and they need to be saying the same thing. Against this background, our speakers today will examine the relationship between law, ethics and culture in the banking sector. And I have pleasure in calling on our first speaker, Mark Carney, Governor of the Bank of England. Mark.
Thank you very much, Colette. Thank you, President Dudley, Lord Chief Justice, for joining this session. It's a great honor for me to host this event and be part of this distinguished panel. We're here because over the course of the past decade, banking has suffered two crises, crises of solvency, crises of legitimacy. The first is really being addressed. It's being addressed by comprehensive reforms, and as a consequence, we have a banking system that's much stronger, more liquid, and much more focused. But that immense progress risks being overshadowed by the second crisis, the crisis of legitimacy. A series of scandals from mis-selling to manipulation have undermined trust in banking, the broader financial system, and to some extent in markets themselves. Now, it's easy to talk about the economic consequences, but just to put it in context, they have been enormous. The misconduct costs of global banks have now reached over $320 billion, capital that could otherwise have supported up to $5 trillion U.S. of lending to households and businesses, the ultimate purpose of the industry. But there's a bigger cost. As an industry of the scale and importance of finance needs social capital as well as economic capital. In other words, it requires the consent of society in order to operate, to innovate, and to grow. And those repeated instances of misconduct have called that social license into question. In a system where trust is fundamental, it ought to be of grave concern that only 20% of UK citizens now think that banks are well run, down from 90% 30 years ago. And this is why the bank has been pursuing a series of measures to turn the tide of ethical drift to one of ethical lift. Domestically, we're working closely with the FCA and Her Majesty's Treasury. And internationally, we've helped catalyze a series of actions at the FSB and G20, actions that will be brought together and presented to the G20 Leaders Summit this July. So what I'd like to do is review some of those main elements, but really concentrate on codes of conduct and the senior manager's regime and how that combination can help lift standards and improve culture. But let me also be clear right at the outset that the Bank of England holds itself to the highest standards. And in that spirit, I'll extend my remarks to review some of the lessons that we, the bank, can learn from the events surrounding Charlotte Hogg's resignation and outline some of the steps that we're taking in response. So let me briefly go through some of those elements of an action plan to improve conduct for the financial system as a whole. It does begin with the law. It does begin with stronger deterrence, and a variety of measures have been done around market abuse recently. But authorities cannot and should not try to legislate for every circumstance. We can't watch every transaction. We certainly can't anticipate every market innovation. And so while fines and sanctions have roles in deterring misconduct, they won't, on their own, bring about the cultural change that the industry needs, which is why we're all here this morning. Now, part of the answer is a greater emphasis on ex-ante incentives for individuals, and ultimately, a more complete grounding in improved firm culture. Incentives start with the most basic, which is to reduce opportunities for bad behavior, and that's the basics of one of the reasons for the overhaul in benchmarks in fixed income and currency markets. More fundamentally, it does require compensation rules that align better risk and reward, and in many respects, the United Kingdom has led the way there. In order to address rolling bad apples, mechanisms are now in place here in the UK to ensure that when individuals move on, their history will be known to those who consider hiring them. And I'm pleased to see that the FSB is now considering whether to adopt this approach more broadly. So, this is all constructive, but it's insufficient. And that's why we're also pursuing measures to ensure firms and their employees take more responsibility for their conduct. UK authorities have used their convening powers to encourage market participants to establish standards of market practice that are well understood, widely followed, and crucially, that keep pace with market developments. And this is part of what the BSB is doing, by promoting higher standards of conduct and confidence. Higher standards of conduct and confidence across the entire UK banking system. And it's what Mark Gallup and the FIC Market Standard Board are doing in establishing readily understood standards for their markets. And it's why the Global FX Committees will launch in May the first globally consistent code of conduct for FX markets, something Bill and I and other governors approved in Basel yesterday. But codes are of little use if nobody reads them, follows, or enforces them. And that's where the UK's senior manager's regime comes into play. In the UK, senior managers are now held accountable if they fail to take reasonable steps to prevent or stop regulatory breaches in their areas of responsibility. The SMR also prescribes responsibilities, typically to the chair and the CEO respectively, for developing and embedding a firm's culture. Although the SMR is only a year old and we're all learning by doing, there are encouraging signs that it's beginning to make a difference. For firms, the SMR is clarifying and improving governance, accountability, and decision-making processes. Senior managers are increasingly focused on building cultures of risk awareness, openness, and ethical behavior. In the words of one of the chairmen, responsibility for culture has moved to the top of my agenda. For supervisors, the SMR is incredibly helpful. The regime's helping to identify weaknesses in governance and accountability, and it gives them something to encourage the necessary changes. We're seeing adoption spread. Some international firms are applying it across their global operations, and the FSB is now explicitly reviewing the merits of such responsibility mapping. The SMR has also been adopted by the Bank of England. And we chose to do so because our mission demands that we hold ourselves to the highest standards of governance and accountability. Now, one of our colleagues, appointed Deputy Governor for Markets and Banking, Charlotte Hogg, had previously not disclosed a relevant family relationship, as was required under our staff code of conduct. For those who have questioned whether we get it, we do. We know this honest mistake was a serious mistake, one that was compounded by the fact that Charlotte Hogg was also responsible for the code. In fact, she had overseen its development. So we were clear up front that there must be consequences, both for her and for the Bank of England. Our minimum response would obviously be what we would expect to see in the firms that we supervise. So let's be absolutely clear about that baseline. In analogous situations in the private sector, we as supervisors expect, first, evidence that the firm is taking the matter seriously. Secondly, proportionate consequences for the individual, including some form of disciplinary warning and possibly some impact on remuneration. And thirdly, a wider review of lessons learned if there's evidence, any evidence, that there is a more systematic problem. Now consider the bank's response to Charlotte Hogg's case. She was formally warned in the strongest and most public of terms. There were consequences for her compensation. Well, she can't forfeit a bonus as a Deputy Governor of the Bank of England, since under statute you can't receive a bonus as a Governor of the Bank of England. She did waive her salary increase. Court reassigned her responsibilities as Chief Operating Officer. Court reconfigured reporting lines and internal structures to improve governance, compliance, and disciplinary processes. And that included the SMR responsibility for the code. And on the basis of this one incident, the independent directors of court have initiated a widespread review that will draw on the expertise of the Independent Evaluation Office, the bank's internal audit function, and the National Audit Office. And those results will be made public. In other words, consistent with our higher standards, the bank planned a tougher response than we would expect from the private sector, but one that, in our judgment, was still proportionate to an honest mistake that was freely and transparently admitted. Now, the Treasury Select Committee reached its own judgment, which in turn triggered Charlotte Hogg's decision to resign. And I and we fully respect the TSC's judgment and her decision. I wanted to speak to this, not to debate the rights and wrongs of this case, but instead to highlight some lessons that the bank and the industry might draw from it. Now, in particular, as a supervisor, I want to dispel the urban myth that has developed around these events. While the PRA can impose financial penalties and suspension under the senior manager's regime, we do not run for our regulated entities a disproportionate one strike and you're out regime for an honest mistake. Neither explicitly or implicitly. Not I as governor, not the CEO of the PRA, not the CEO of the FCA, not any of our supervisors. The SMR is about clear responsibilities, proportionate consequences, and developing a culture of openness and accountability. Proportionate means taking into account the severity of the incident, the track record of the individual and their firm, as well as the firm's wider response. An honest mistake that is freely admitted for which a firm takes prompt remedial action is not a firing offense. And here's my point. We must not let recent events inadvertently tighten perceived standards for the industry, because that could leave senior managers in the private sector running scared. It could drive compliance underground and undermine our collective objectives. Another risk, flagged by some, is that it will also could become harder to find candidates of sufficient caliber to take on senior roles. And this is why last week I spoke with the CEOs or chairs of all the major banks to reiterate our expectation as regulators. And I'm glad I did, because to an individual, they were all concerned about precisely these unintended consequences. To be clear, the best in the industry are committed to making the SMR work, not because they have to, but because a regime with clear responsibilities, proportionate consequences, and a culture of openness helps to build a culture that will over time regain trust for the industry. So to conclude, changes to incentives, new codes, and a clearer mapping of responsibilities will all help improve culture and lay the groundwork, just the groundwork, for a better culture. Of course, integrity can't be bought nor regulated. Even with the best possible framework of codes and principles, the soundest compensation schemes, the most committed efforts to improve transparency, bankers, whether in the private or the public sector, must consistently challenge themselves and the standards they uphold. We're seeking to raise expectations and norms by using a combination of hard and soft law, with much of the latter developed by the private sector. The best view finance as a profession whose purpose is client service. They see themselves as custodians of their institutions and have a sense of responsibility for the system. We know at the bank that cultural change takes time from our own efforts. And we know that the changes we've made to governance will bear fruit. We've made strides, but we know we have more to do. And that's why our independent non-executive directors are reviewing the bank's response, all aspects of the bank's response to recent events, and why they will publish the results of their analysis. That's why our next strategic plan will focus to an even greater degree on changing how we work. In order to maximize the potential of all the people at the Bank of England, we need to fully embrace collaborative working with diverse teams that value robust debate. And we also need to improve how we communicate, both internally and externally. We want to have all our colleagues feel empowered to raise issues properly, to challenge, and to voice any concerns they have. It's initiatives like these that will help us reinforce the trust that is crucial to delivering our mission, and they'll help us merit that trust by making us more effective at the same time. The Bank of England will learn the lessons of these recent unfortunate events, and we'll apply those lessons to reinforce what's best in banking and what's best in the Bank of England. Thank you very much. I look forward to the discussion.
Thank you very much, Governor. I'd now like to invite President Dudley to introduce his remarks. Bill.
Thank you. I want to thank Governor Carney, with Lord Chief Justice, and Dame Collette for including me in today's discussion. It's an honor to be here. I'd also like to thank the Banking Standards Board for its important work on improving standards of conduct in financial services. I think the effects of this work will, over time, be felt not just in the City of London, but throughout the industry globally. As always, what I have to say today reflects my own views and not necessarily those of the FOMC or the Federal Reserve System. So we learned from the LIBOR and FX scandals that poor conduct can proliferate quickly throughout the global marketplace. That's because short-term thinking, maxing out this year's compensation bonus or this year, quarter's accounting profits, can be a catalyst for poor conduct. In contrast, good conduct takes much longer to catch on. Good conduct depends on a longer-term frame of reference. It's building a viable career that one can be proud of, and at the firm level, building franchise value and reputation that takes decades to accomplish. In both cases, though, the same enabling mechanism is at work, culture. Culture within a firm or across an industry is not determined primarily by rules or laws, though certainly rules or laws can amplify good or bad attributes. Culture comprises instead what people observe and do, resulting in accepted and mostly unspoken norms. Mostly people look for what succeeds and what does not, and they try to align themselves with the former. we want to improve culture and conduct, we need to start by being realistic about human behavior. At the New York Fed's culture conference last October, Dame Manoush Shafiq observed pragmatically that an end to all misconduct is not the goal of this effort. There always will be a few bad apples. Rather, the goal should be far fewer instances of misconduct with far less scope, magnitude, and duration when such misconduct inevitably occurs. I submit that the best way to keep problems small is to encourage a culture that spots issues and issues early and raises concerns early. In my view, the most dangerous type of culture in financial service in finance occurs when people see something wrong, but they don't say something. I think back to the chat room transcripts from the LIBOR and FX scandals. The way traders communicated so openly about their manipulation of markets makes it hard to imagine that nobody else in their firms knew what was happening. So why didn't these people say something? Now, there are understandable human tendencies that cause each of us to not want to rock the boat. People want to be perceived as team players. Those behavioral traits can be amplified through a firm's culture, which can weigh on one's willingness to do the right thing. This is, unfortunately, what seems to have happened at Wells Fargo, one of the largest retail banks in the United States. Whether to obtain a bonus or to simply keep a job, employees felt that they had to keep quiet and meet sales targets despite the cost to their customers. So how do you change a culture where silence leads to misconduct? Well, I'm going to offer two ideas that I think might help and one that definitely will not. Here's what will not work: merely telling your employees to speak up. Cultures do not change simply by exhortation. Eloquent speeches, a well-phrased value statement, an annual requirement to acknowledge the code of conduct, that's just not sufficient. So that's the easy one. So what are the two ideas that might help? Those are a little bit harder. Well, first, it's really important that managers lead by example. Senior executives must be seen within their firms to expect and respect challenges, and in turn must challenge ideas themselves. And they have to explain difficult decisions to their employees, sharing not only the news of what's been done, but why has it been done. More important, mid-level managers have to do the same thing. Of course, mid-level managers will not generally behave that way unless they see their senior leadership setting the same example. Second, if your organization values people when they raise their hand, the incentives within the organization have to reflect that. Employees who speak up should be recognized positively. The courage it takes to speak up, despite the perceived cost, should be counted as a positive factor in evaluations. And where raising one's hand has saved the firm's money and reputation by avoiding or keeping a problem small, that action should be rewarded. It's only natural for an economist like me to consider the issue of unintended consequences. One that comes to mind is, if we follow this course, would we create a culture of distrust and suspicion where everyone would be looking over his or her shoulder? That, of course, would be unfortunate and costly. But I think it's more likely that we'll get a much better result than that, a different cultural result. Instead, talented and conscientious people will be happy to remain at a firm or within the industry because their personal and professional values will be well aligned. Such employees will feel relief that they can speak up without fear of reprisal and that they can enjoy a clear conscience for having done the right thing. I think there's a significant value in being able to sleep well at night. Moreover, being receptive to diverse and dissenting views will also likely yield better results. It's in the industry's self-interest to deter silence, not only because money will be saved on fines not incurred for misconduct, but also because better ideas will be brought to the table. I believe that business performance will benefit from having a culture in which people feel empowered to speak up. So let me give you a few examples from my own experience at the New York Fed. I want employees in our bank to speak up. That's why at the start of my tenure as president, I made it clear that I wanted the best idea to win, regardless of where it originated in the institution, and even if it contradicted something that I thought was best. In some instances, that will require people to admit mistakes. In this regard, I've tried to set the example that we all make mistakes, and that recognizing and addressing them head-on, and importantly, learning from them, is the best approach. So let me give you an example of this. A few years ago, we created a new group at the New York Fed called the Integrative Policy Analysis Group. Its purpose was to consolidate teams from many parts of the organization to develop a more integrated view of the economic and financial environment, and that this would be, then help us inform us in terms of the conduct of our policy responsibilities. I was probably the strong and leading advocate for this idea. But after 2 years of effort, it became clear to me and others that this was not working as well as we'd hoped. There was a lot of reasons for that, and in the end, we dissolved the group and reassigned the work and staff. I let our employees know that I took a calculated risk, and it was a calculated risk that did not work out. By doing this, I aim to show that when things do not go as planned, the best approach is to address it, not remain silent. I hope that when our people are confronted with disappointing results in their work, they will do the same going forward. Now, I mentioned earlier that we also need to reform incentives in order to encourage people to speak up. That's hard. So I'll share with you some of the change we've made at the New York Fed, recognizing that we don't have a monopoly on good ideas, nor can we claim to have a perfect culture. Skip-level meetings are common and occur for the purpose of providing forums for sharing ideas. They are also a signal that escalation of problems does matter to us. We offer training for new employees that emphasizes the importance of cognitive diversity and speaking up. We evaluate employees on their level of engagement with other colleagues and their willingness to share insights. So part of getting promoted is contributing diverse views and raising your hand. We've created programs to encourage peer recognition of good ideas, including backing for actionable initiatives initiated by staff. This resulted, for example, in ideas like a Share Your Story series to create institutional memory of past experiences and lessons within the bank. Now, none of these ideas is a panacea, and I know that we haven't yet achieved our goal, a culture in which employees perceive that by raising their hands and challenging what may be orthodoxy or conventional wisdom, they are contributing to the mission of the New York Fed. I hope, however, that with the right incentives and good leadership models, we can move closer to that ideal state, an organization characterized by fresh ideas and open dialogue. Now, at conferences like these, we tend to focus on the cost of misconduct. But getting rid of scandals should not be the sole reason for changing culture. The public expects more from the financial sector than the lack of another financial crisis or scandal. The industry would do well to listen to Baroness Honora O'Neill. Think about your purpose. What are you for? Surely no one would answer that question by saying, "We're for the lack of misconduct." Rather, the financial services industry should support a well-functioning, growing economy, reflecting the interests of all its stakeholders. Banking, in particular, should provide critical intermediation services, the economic infrastructure that allows businesses to grow, families to save and invest, and standards of living to improve across generations for as broad a cross-section of people as possible. When society prospers, the financial services industry prospers as well. Creating a culture that encourages and rewards diversity of thought, perspective, and experience is one means by which the industry can do good and do well at the same time. Thank you.
Thank you very much to President Duffy. I'd now like to invite the Lord Chief Justice, Lord Thomas.
Dame Colette, it's a great pleasure and privilege for me to be able to join everyone here this morning, particularly the Governor and the President, because I think it's important that we see what we do as a coherent whole between those whose experience is the law and those whose experience is banking and the financial markets. I speak with some trepidation about what makes up banking, but I think it can be said to be built on four pillars. expertise, innovation, law and its young cousin regulation, ethics and integrity. Those are obviously interconnected, and we depend, and I think the financial system depends on the strength of each. I think the global financial crisis revealed, first, that the pillar of law and regulation needed strengthening, and second, that the pillar that consists of ethics and integrity was too weak, and I regret to say, remains too weak. Now, law and regulation now, by and large, though with some exceptions that must be ironed out, as a coherent whole. But it's good, I think, to look back a little before 1982. Before that time, apart from statutory regulation directed largely at solvency, and save where the criminal law intervened on occasions or on the very few disciplinary proceedings that ever took place, the power of regulation was effectively the ability of the chairman of the city institutions, such as Lloyd's or the Stock Exchange, and the power of the governor to remove from the system those whose conduct was considered harmful or those who did not live up to the very high standards. During the 1970s, that system began to crumble. And hence, dating from the passing of the Lloyd's Act 1982, the reforms of the Financial Services Act 1986, and culminating the 2000 Act, a comprehensive system of regulation was established. I think many of us, or those who are a little older, will recall that they thought, wonderful, we've now got a system that will deal with the financial markets and remedy what had been the vacuum. It would operate in such a way to make those actually responsible accountable, whatever their seniority. It was simply not good enough to go over those at the bottom of a pyramid. I think, and it is with regret I say, that the system was not as good as we thought it to be. Fortunately, since the financial crisis, much essential work has been done to make the system work more effectively. I think the courts and the regulators are respectively playing their parts, for example, by being tough on those who've broken the law or regulatory regimes. But I think it's only right to observe that only few cases have been brought. And I shall return to this subject of deterrence. However, it is clear that law and regulation on their own can never be enough. Even if we're agreed on principles that should apply, it has never been enough. And I think it's important to reflect on the basic principles in which our common law and the law of other nations was developed. And that is, business life was conducted and is conducted on the assumption that you choose carefully the person with whom you do business and enter into business only with a person in whom you can believe you can trust. That is because it is quite impossible to devise a legal or regulatory regime that can supervise the conduct of every party to a bargain. Unless you wish to buy yourself a dispute, you should never contemplate entering into a contract with someone you don't trust. And perhaps it's a marked feature of a failure to understand this basic principle that have led many people to believe that the law or a good contract can solve all problems. I think this is fundamentally to misunderstand the limited role of the law and regulatory regimes. As we find with many things, people of the 19th century put things rather well. And Lord Justice Bowen, by way of illustration, said in 1883, mercantile genius consists principally in knowing whom to trust and with whom to deal. And I think we forget that at our peril. Let me just take, by way of example, the late Mr. Robert Maxwell. In a report published in 1971, inspectors appointed by the predecessor of the Department of Business, etc., had concluded that he was not a person who could be relied on to exercise proper stewardship of a publicly quoted company. In 1988, when Mr. Maxwell applied to the then regulator to be the chairman of the investment managers of a pension fund, he was approved. The very distinguished chairman of the regulator was recorded as observing that it was, and I quote, a pity that we could not exclude that crook. He was in effect driven to that view because Mr. Maxwell was the kind of businessman, and they abound, who will challenge the regulator in court and challenge every bit of evidence upon which the regulator would seek to rely. As Mike Ernst-Becker and I concluded in 2001 in a report into Mirror Group newspapers, an approval by a regulator is more in the nature of a negative clearance rather than a positive approval. And it seems to me, therefore, one has to face up to the limited effectiveness that the law and regulation can ever hope to achieve in the fair and proper conduct of the markets. Therefore, that's the first reason why we cannot leave this pillar of integrity and ethics underdeveloped. But there is another reason, which I think it's important to examine. Some years ago, it was, I think, possible to go into a market when you were 18, possibly 21, maybe a bit older, and you could happily work with the knowledge you then acquired for the rest of your life without learning, without needing to learn much that was new. Things have changed. Innovation is in every part of our system. But the problem with innovation is that as regards the law and regulation, it takes time to catch up. In our common law world, and I think I can't miss the opportunity to say what a wonderful system our common law is, we can move more rapidly forward. But we need disputes. If we depend on regulation, it's inevitable that time is needed to agree on principles applicable to an innovative product. Therefore, what we need to be sure of is that we have good ethical standards that can underpin the development of innovation, just as it's necessary to cure the limited effect of law and regulation. Now, how are we to do this? And this is the fundamental challenge that we face. I am strongly supportive of the work being done, and we are so fortunate to have Dame Colette pushing forward this work. And I very strongly support the work that the Judiciary is doing with leading academics through the Law and Ethics in Finance projects. But I thought it might, rather than tell people whose business I don't know very well what to do, I thought I might say just a little bit about the legal system. Because I don't think it will surprise you to know, it is integrity and ethics that are critical to making it work. It will not work on regulation and law alone. Now, what are the principles that underpin what we do? First, I think many lawyers, and I hope some will forgive this, look on it as a vocation, and we must foster that vocation. Maybe you can apply that to banking. Second, and this is critical, there must be a simple code of ethical standards. And it's critical that we don't draft something long and tedious over which lawyers can look at and say, ah, you're just outside that, but you can do it. We look at the culture and we look at the spirit. Third, it seems to me, that we must be proactive in educating the standards from the start of everyone's professional career. And the responsibility for that lies fairly and squarely on senior leaders to set an example. Fourth, we must inculcate a culture of adherence to those standards. Now, we're quite lucky in the courts, and I'm not certain what the parallel is in banking, but every lawyer owes to the court a duty that overrides the duty to the client. Fifth, we have a culture of accountability for those standards with clear transparency. And I think we've developed in the courts processes for ensuring what is called explanatory accountability. We will expose, and we do expose, to public criticism those who've fallen below high ethical standards. And we've had to do this, and it's not very pleasant to do it, because we found that disciplinary proceedings under regulation are not effective and not as rapid as they should be. And courts cannot operate without the highest standards of integrity. Sixth, it is important that the public and the profession recognise and appreciate those who abide by standards. It is those who act with integrity and in the performance of their duty who are trusted by the judges and trusted by their professional colleagues. The incentive is to win the highest accolade, professional respect, and the ease of doing business with your colleagues. And seventh, it is the interaction of these various matters or actions that I believe provides the necessary incentives, because you have to have those, and the necessary deterrence. I share with both the Governor and the President that there will always be some who will never act with integrity. One would be living in cloud cuckoo land if one thought that would be so. But our objective is to ensure that they are as few as possible. And above all, they do not damage the integrity and the reputation of our system on which so much of our prosperity and good fortune depends. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Lord Chief Justice. You've given us a lot to think about there, and in particular, thanks for your stout defence of the common law. Not a surprise, but it's always good to hear it. Now, we have got some time for questions, comments, etc. I don't know whether we've got any microphones in this room. Yes, we have. People with microphones. Before I throw it open to the floor, there's one person who I would like to ask to comment, who is sitting right here in the front row. This is Honora O'Neill, who has been much referenced in this debate very widely, and as many of you will know, is I think, the leading proponent, if that's the right word, Honora, of the study of ethics in all its dimensions in this country. And for those of you who don't know this, last week was awarded an extremely prestigious international prize for her many years of work in this area. Now, Honora, you've spoken about these topics a great deal. You gave the Reith Lectures on trust a few years ago. Would you like to make any comments on what you've heard here this morning?
Thank you, Colette. What I heard is actually very encouraging. It is encouraging, I have to say, because my subject, ethics, which has been pretty well derided in the 20th century, seems to be creeping back in, and perhaps not before time. I'm the first to say it was the fault of the philosophers that ethics fell into disrepute. Go back to Vienna in the 1930s, and many of you will know what I'm talking about. But I think we're back, and I think we should try to be robust and rigorous. So I've got a question that is partly for President Dudley and maybe partly for the Lord Chief Justice, which is about the question of transparency. Now, of all the virtues that were mentioned in the last hour, transparency is the newcomer. I can't really see Aquinas or John Stuart Mill saying, the big trouble is not enough transparency. Transparency appeared, of course, with the technologies that enable it, and alas, enable it without necessarily too much regard to truth and falsity. And yet, we know that this came in with the revolution of accountability, perhaps dating to the 80s. How much can transparency achieve for us? President Dudley suggested that speaking up was an important thing. And I think speaking up is very important because it puts things into the public domain. It is an exercise of transparency. But then we have that difficult question, who's listening? And it may be that we ought to shift our focus from mere transparency, getting it out there, speaking up, to questions about communication, effective communication, and ethically responsible communication. I think that's a very difficult one, And yet, my sense is more necessary than ever in the world of mediated communication, social media, not to mention fake news and truthiness. So rather a broad question, but I'd be very interested in your comments.
Honora, thank you very much. So a question, first of all, for Bill, and then I think for Lord Thomas.
Okay, well, I think, you know, my own view would be that the reason why transparency is so important is it's a mechanism of building trust. So let's just take the BSB surveys. So should firms share those results with their firms or not? If they do share the results with their firms, then that's being more transparent. And that's sort of trusting that the employees can sort of take on the information that the firm has gathered or not. So I think the reason I think transparency makes sense here is it's really a mechanism by which to build trust. Now, I completely agree with you that effective communication, you know, transparency is not sufficient. There has to be someone who's actually willing to receive the message. And there has to be a way to then induce collaboration between the person that's sending the message and the person that's receiving the message. So transparency is sort of a necessary condition, but I don't think it's sufficient. I mean, what we found at the Federal Reserve in the time that I've been there is we moved a long way towards transparency, not just in terms of how we do work internally, but also in terms of how we communicate to the public. And I think the reason for that is in part because what the Federal Reserve did during the financial crisis, people didn't understand very well, and it actually did actually erode the trust of our citizens in the Federal Reserve as an institution. So again, the transparency in that case was to help to rebuild trust by being more open about what we're doing, why we're doing it, and explain ourselves better to the public.
Thank you, Bill. John, did you have a just on this?
Very quickly. First of all, justice is done openly, and virtually everything we do is open. Therefore, communication is the nature of what we do. And I mean communication by our judgments, not by spin. Point one. Point two is what is important is to communicate to the community that is in error, namely, in the case of the legal profession, the lawyers, or in the case of banking, no doubt other bankers. You have a broader duty to communicate to make certain the system is understood. And what is so important, and I think any market shows it, that actually the public acknowledgement that something has gone wrong, even if made public to a small number of people, news travels fast in any profession. And I think that that is a very, very strong deterrent to people who transgress. You very rarely can keep your reputation intact if once your wrongdoing or your failure to live up to ethical standards has been made public. And we don't do enough of that, in my view.
Mark, would you like to
Come in? Just very briefly, last 25, 30 years in central banking has been a revolution in transparency. It's almost as if we've taken it as far as we possibly can. When we make a decision, our minutes are instantly released. Our minutes of our court used to have to wait a century to get them. Now you have to wait 6 weeks. No one waited a century, by the way, to get them. And so I think part of which you understand better than I, but part of this is about the limits of transparency and more about, I mean, you don't establish, as you pointed out in the past, you don't establish trust by people seeing absolutely everything you do because there's no context, there's no shared understanding necessarily. And so that, and I just very lightly touched on it in my remarks, is half of what we're thinking of doing for the next several years is thinking much harder about how we communicate in words that people can understand, that we're explaining core concepts, whether about what we do or about the economy, so that people have context with which to challenge us better, and obviously using different media so that we have facts out there in reliable ways, in a much broader sense. So the general point would be yes, I think we are reaching the limits of transparency, and in fact, we've almost carpet bombed the public with information about the bank that they don't. Well, they certainly don't have time to digest it all, and we're not necessarily doing it in a way that they could digest it all, given that they're not central bankers 24/7, and more power to them for not being so. Yeah.
Well, thank you. You raise a very interesting point about how one can help people, I suppose, to engage with these important issues, number one. I mean, we used to talk about how can you communicate really well. We're now in a, also grappling with some of the issues that Honora touched on about fakery, lying, all of those things that people don't seem to want to call lies, but they call them slightly more appealing things like fake news. And I just wonder whether anybody here, and I'm going to now look at some of our journalistic colleagues, but whether you think actually this has got so much more difficult because we are living in a world of, as it were, contested reality. Alex Brummer, I'm going to embarrass you by, those who don't know, this is Alex Brummer of the Daily Mail. Alex, and I'm sure this is something you and your colleagues think about a great deal. Is there some trick we're missing here? I mean, is there, or are we fighting a hopeless uphill battle in a world where lies have as much currency as truth?
It's about standards and ethics and so on. And really the issue is about the rise of new media, or it's the media which is not like the traditional media, where things are not properly checked and monitored and, mm-hmm. and quantified and investigated. You couldn't do an investigation, you couldn't trust an investigation like one in today's Guardian about HSBC and allegations of money laundering from Russia. You couldn't trust it if it appeared on Google or on Facebook or anywhere else or on one of the new media sites, because we know that the monitoring stages which have gone through, the behaviours which have been built into newspapers and into BBC and good media sources over generations just don't exist in those new media sites. And the monitoring isn't there. It's all about getting information out there whether it's true or not. And that's a real problem. And it's a problem for journalists too, because there's a pressure from news desks to follow up on these leaks, and then traditional journalism ends up cutting corners in doing that. I have one question myself, which I'm going to ask you about the actual.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Is it on the same topic, Alex?
That's slightly outside.
It's in the same room.
I suddenly thought you were going to change the subject.
Everybody inside the major money center banks, or whatever you like to call them, investment banks, had access to this information about the LIBOR traffic and so on, the conversations which were taking
place. I don't know if everybody did. I don't know if everybody did, but presumably more people knew than just the people in the chat rooms.
Presumably senior managers had access to that data and information, yet we've seen very few prosecutions or disciplinary action against senior people. And I just wonder why that happened. And is there a flaw in the law, a flaw in the enforcement process, which meant that the senior guys, the top guys, got away with it?
Okay, Alex, thanks. That's a question for Bill, but it might also be,
that'd be a good question for the Lord Chief Justice.
A question for the Governor and indeed for the Lord Chief Justice. Bill, do you want to be the person that tries to deal with this first?
Well, I don't want to practice law without a license. So. But I do think that this issue that people haven't gone to, as many people haven't gone to jail, does play into a very bad narrative about the financial crisis. In other words, you had a horrible financial crisis, a lot of households, people lost their jobs, they lost their homes, and yet all these things were done. There were a lot of fines, but where was the punishment of the senior management? I think, you know, it's a couple of issues. One, doing foolish things is not against the law, so that's problem number one. And problem two, it's just hard to assemble a case of facts to actually be successful in prosecution. But I think, you know, just sitting back, not as the president of the New York Fed, but just as a citizen, I would have liked to have seen a little bit more even balance.
Okay. Lord Thomas, can I ask you, I think if I was a Daily Mail journalist, I would be putting the question slightly less favourably than Alex did, which is, why aren't more people in jail?
I am afraid I can only answer this in a very limited way, as LIBOR cases are proceeding through the courts, and I have sat on appeal on two of them. So I will answer the question not by reference to LIBOR, but by reference to the way in which prosecutions have taken place. I think that the Serious Fraud Office has, over the last 3 or 4 years, really turned itself around. If I go back to safer times, to the late 1970s, early 1980s, attempts to prosecute senior people largely failed because the prosecution wasn't done competently. I can say that quite safely because I was at the bar then and I saw what happened. And I think that if you are looking at the way a prosecution system works, the deterrent aspect must be to go to those who have been dishonest, and at the highest level you can find that dishonesty. And you must pursue it with vigor. That is not a comment in relation to LIBOR, it's a general comment, but it's certainly what I saw at a time I can safely speak about because no one is alive. It seems to me that we need a vigorous prosecution system, properly resourced, and I think the SFO has done a good job. But I'm sorry, I can't comment on libel.
Okay,
so,
Governor.
Let me take it from the world of criminal misconduct to widespread misconduct or poor market practice. And that's where what I was speaking to, the senior manager's regime, comes into play. So there's a common refrain, and I won't speak to the specifics of the issue you raised, but there's a common refrain with a series of misconducts, whether it was mis-selling mortgages or PPI, whatever. Senior management didn't know what was going on. That is not a defense under the senior manager's regime anymore. Yes, if it's one person, idiosyncratic behavior, mid-level of the institution, I mean, you can't expect. But if it's in any way systematic, it means that you haven't put in place, as senior manager, the training for those individuals. You haven't put in place a proper compliance function. You haven't, if you're the CEO, you haven't helped embed the right culture. And therefore, there will be consequences. There won't necessarily be legal consequences, because the bar is appropriately different. But that's the big difference. It answers some of what you're getting at. And I will reinforce what Bill has said, which is that, of course, this is, I mean, it's striking to me personally, having come here, just how strong and understandably strong the feeling is about this issue in this country.
Thank you very much. Now, I can see a couple of hands over there. Norina, would you like to, have you got a mic? Can we have a microphone? What evidence is there that this has had any significant impact? That's the first question. The second question is off topic but important, Governor. Inflation data has just come out. Inflation is 2.3% or 2.3% in February, faster than the Bank of England expected. How concerned are you about speed?
Okay. So your second question sort of undermines your first question, Norina. Look, single data point, you never overreact to a single data point. We're talking about much bigger issues than monthly data. And so I'm going to focus on that as is appropriate. In terms of evidence of impact, and let me say a couple things on it. One is that a lot of what we are seeing emerge in the public domain, whether it's through the courts, whether it's specific fines, relate to events that happened in and around the financial crisis or in the immediate aftermath. So you know, the wheels of justice and regulation sometimes grind quite slowly. They get there in the end, but they grind slowly. So there is a lagged effect. That is not to say there is not misconduct in the sector still, and it's not to be complacent at all about the progress. We are seeing, though, evidence in terms of the effectiveness of some of the measures that have been put in place. Firms are using these measures, the sort of soft measures, if you will,
There's a lot of clawback of bonuses, as one would expect, which we see. We, as the supervisor, know, as does the FCA, when that happens. We follow up frequently on exactly what were the circumstances around it. There are cases of where firms have been applying sanction to their employees for shortcomings under the SMR. Again, because you have much clearer, senior manager's regime, because you have much clearer accountability, it's much easier to do that. And again, as supervisors, it's much more straightforward for us to go in at the highest levels of the organization, ask the questions, put the pressure on, catalyze action if appropriate. So we are seeing it work, but these are, you know, it's, if you have a tide of ethical drift and you are trying to turn it, it takes time. And it takes time to have meaningful cultural change, and it requires sustained focus. So early days, turning, not fully turned, and warrants all the attention that's been given to it.
Would anybody else like to come in on this?
Sure.
Not necessarily the UK inflation figures. But
no, I'm not gonna comment on the UK inflation figures. You can be sure of that. I think that the fact that the fines have been so large has raised questions about whether these firms are actually too big to manage. And I think the senior management of these firms know that that's a real question that's out there. And so I think as a consequence of that, they view this as a very existential situation, that if they don't get this in hand, there's going to be really questions whether firms of this nature are going to be able to continue to be allowed to exist. So that's number one. So I think the firms that I interact with, I think they're taking this very, very seriously for good reason. You know, I don't think this is just a public relations exercise. The second thing I would say is that every time that something new is revealed, I think we're seeing now more people respond and say, okay, if that happened to them, do I have that same issue in my own house? So yeah. Let's take the Wells Fargo situation in terms of sales incentives. So basically what they were doing is they had very strong incentives to sell more, open more accounts for their customers, and that obviously, and people were paid on that basis. That was a very flawed set of incentives. A number of firms that I've talked to have gone to their own organizations and looked across their own set of sales incentives and asked themselves, okay, what are we doing? That's a lot of progress. One thing that I was very disappointed when we saw the, after the LIBOR scandal, is we saw the FX rate fixing. Yeah. And I didn't see that behavior at that time. Once LIBOR came out, you would have thought that the senior management of the firms would have gone and looked at all their trading activity and asked themselves, do they have any similar problems elsewhere in their organization? And I don't really get the sense that that happened as strongly as I would have liked. So I see the behavior changing. And I think, you know, the efforts of the Banking Standards Board, I think, is pushing in the right direction. So I think, as Mark said, it's going to take time. I mean, this is, you know, most of the stuff that we're seeing is pretty old that you're seeing the fines for. Not always, but most of it's pretty old. Okay. But it's moving on.
Thank you, Bill. John, did you want to?
Right.
You had your hand up for, you're my non-colleague from the BBC.
Right? Yeah.
I'm not sure that mic is on, by the way.
I'll repeat the question.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Yeah.
I was just wondering, despite the big fines we talked about today, we went this morning to pages of The Guardian, which had UK banks laundering hundreds of millions of pounds out of Russia. We haven't had any comment from the Financial Conduct Authority on that yet, as it's arrived, or considered here. And I wonder if the government, if you would like to respond to that, what action you are considering taking. And then further to that, about the
Well, let me, I'll pick up on the last bit of what Simon said, which is, why don't you ask the question, I decide what I say, it's the way it normally works. It's accountability, smart transparency, Simon, is what it is. I think the point on the last bit, which is that there has been a greater weight on the cost to the institution and the shareholders, those $320 billion of fines, than there has been on individual accountability. And therefore, a lot of what has been done over the last several years has to rebalance that. It's not saying that firms shouldn't pay the right fine if they do something wrong. They should, absolutely. But that the individuals were not bearing the responsibility for what they what happened on their watch or what they actually did. And that goes, that has to go beyond the legal aspect of it in terms of the standards they're observing, in terms of the implications for their own compensation, et cetera. And so that's a number of the measures that have been put in place that I went through go exactly to that point. And in terms of, I'll make two other comments. I will say two words on your first point. One thing in terms of progress to Narina Hertz's question, is that whether it's through the institutions that are members of the BSB and the progress that's being made there, or the fact that we have 17 on last count of the global systemic banks as part of the Fixed Income Market Standard Board, all the major institutions as part of this FX Code of Conduct, they are defining what best practice is in these markets. And that matters. That matters in the UK, because once you define it, then you have a responsibility for making sure that you put in place the systems and the people and the understanding and the culture to follow it. And that is the industry getting it, and it has to be followed through. So I would reemphasize that on both those points. On the, in terms of a specific reported allegation against a specific firm, I don't think it is going to surprise you that, and particularly since it's a conduct issue and the FCA is in the lead, I don't think it will surprise you that I'm not going to make a specific comment on that.
Okay, now I know there are some more questions from that, from our colleagues in the media, but I just want to slightly shift the lens for a moment, because one of the things that each of our panelists touched on was the question of standards, professional practice. How professional have you got to be? John, I think it was you that said something rather, you put it rather sharply, is it a vocation? Which is a rather strong way of putting it, but there's an interesting question, which is this a profession? And I think there's two people in the audience who I'd like to hear on this. One is Susan Rice, who is sitting right there. So if Susan Rice could come in. And then Alan Yarrow, who is up here. I would really like to hear their contribution on this point.
Thanks very much. That's all right. Could I just first thank our speakers, because you talked about the how you're dealing with things, and I thought that was very useful. I took away sort of some main points: responsibility of people to choose to do business with those whom they trust, something about responsibility on both sides, the importance of cognitive diversity. I'll come back to these, which is why I'm mentioning it, very important, and banks needing a social license, Mark, which you stated. In addition to the FIC and to the BSB is doing and other bodies, there's an initiative called the Chartered Banker Professional Standards Board, which I've been chairing. A number of our banks, big and small, have been part of this for the last 5 years. We've developed three professional standards for bankers, individual bankers, not for institutions. These are standards of broad knowledge and professional behaviors. And we have about 250,000 bankers who've achieved the foundation standard. This is a work in progress, but it has very much got ahead of steam. And it is around professionalism, but it's around pointing out and describing and putting at the forefront what the importance of the right behaviors. I would just make then two comments. One is, as a banker, a sort of on the ground banker, as a former member of the court at the Bank of England, as a non-executive, and various other hats on the board of Colette's Banking Standards Board, I notice again and again that we in the corporate world describe success in financial terms. It always comes first in the numbers, and we describe failures in behavioral terms, and that's wrong. We should be describing success first and foremost in direction, that's well and good, but that's part of what will lead us to having a real professionalism in this industry. And the final comment about trust is, we used to trust people we could see face to face, you know, you went and saw the bank manager, and now we trust complete strangers online who tell us a hotel or something else is a good thing, and we make personal decisions based on trusting those in whom we have no basis to trust. And I just want to say that I wonder cognitively if we will actually change over time, and leave you with that thought.
Okay, Susan. Alan, would you like to say a word?
Can I first of all congratulate the governor on congratulate the governor on the 15th of the 10th of June 2000, he stood up in front of the city and admitted the plan going to the wrong to the financial crisis. That was a very important statement because then he could move on to what was going to happen. He also recognised the fact that throwing regulation down from an ivory tower onto the market without the practitioner actually supporting it wasn't going to work. And say not marking up to go and set up the fixed interest market. Practitioners would do. Now, the reality is that we then went the next stage further with the senior market review regime, and it started off with the senior manager guilty until proposed incident on the 800th anniversary of the Bank of Charter, which was quite an interesting time to have it. That again was reversed. And I'd like to congratulate the fact that pragmatism and intelligence of what has happened in the course of the last 2 years I think has been very important. However, I was, and probably still am, a wholesale banker. And there's one part of the sector which at the moment is professionally unqualified. And Susan quite rightly pointed out that she's got a lot of bankers effectively who are doing professional qualifications. Yet the wholesale markets now are largely still unqualified professionally. We heard from the Lord Chief Justice a very eloquent and articulate definition as to how it was important to be admired by your own peer group in the lawyers. As far as the wholesale bankers are concerned, what's interesting about that is if you're an accountant or you're a lawyer, you can turn around to your chief executive, I can't do that, it's against the ethics of my profession. If you're not qualified, on the other hand, you can't use that defence. So if I can ask the question again, Governor, do you think it'd be a good idea if the wholesale markets went for all the professional basis in professional regulation?
A direct question. And this is something that you have stressed over the years, including at, I think, the same orders which you hosted, banquet. And I think there's a lot to it. I really do think there's a lot to it. And I think one of the building blocks is, sorry, Mark, to keep going back to the FIC Market Standards Board, but I think that is one of the building blocks, as is the FX Code, because these are the standards of the market. These are the best practices of the market. And then you base your vocation around that. And the way, part of the very early thinking about this was to say that if you are a participant in the wholesale market, what do you believe in? You believe in the market. You believe the market's the best allocation mechanism, it's the fairest, you believe in competition. And there's certain principles of what makes a good market, a fair market, a competitive market. And if you see somebody on the other, next to you on the desk or across the room or in a chat room doing something that undermines the integrity of the market, that's wrong. That goes against your professional ethics, that what you believe in. And that's where you come against the issue that Bill raised in his remarks, which is that, you know, the desire to get along and quite often the people are relatively new or relatively junior and they don't have a point of reference unless they have a proper code which says this is what a real market is. And in the end, people colluding in chat rooms, to use that example, undermine the market and undermine the system for the people that matter, who are ultimately somebody who has a mortgage or a business that's borrowing and hiring people that, you know, the end user, and it's not contained within a game in the city. And so I think I do think you're right, and I think we have one of the main building blocks in being constructed with the market standards. And I would very much welcome if it were a proper vocation, because, you know, the people in those wholesale markets, certainly the best, are in there for their entire professional career, regardless of how much they evolve over time, as long as it's consistent with true market standards.
Thank you. Well, Bill, would you like to?
Yeah, I'm pretty much where Mark is. I guess I would just add one thing. We also need to get the educational institutions to understand that conduct and ethics is important as well. Typically what happens in most of these people don't just become traders. They usually go through some educational program, but the ethics typically is put to the side in a single course. It's not actually embedded in the subject matter that they take. And so I think
partnering with the educational community to make sure that the ethics, conduct, these kind of behavior issues get are part of the core curriculum would also be helpful.
Can I just
Sure.
very quickly on that, which is your grace, sort of in your presence here, but what doesn't work or what rarely works is sort of Aristotelian ethics or high-level ethical principles. So again, going back, so what are mapping those into what is a fair competitive market? Well, that's something they can understand because they believe it, I believe in the market, and therefore that's, and that's, to me, embedding it is partly that.
John, did you want to come in?
Just two things. One, I completely agree. It seems to me that bankers ought to aspire to consider themselves professionals, having a profession. I simply don't understand, unless something's gone topsy-turvy with our society, why someone doesn't want to be a professional. It's very odd. But secondly, I think the very serious point made by is really how do you instill trust when people don't meet? And here I think being part of a professional community is again important. So you can, you know, you ring someone up and say, look, I'm going to deal with someone, I'm going to do it over the phone. What's he like? If you're part of a community, you can do that. And I think making people act in together is very difficult, but it can be done. Because I think most people basically feel they ought to do right. And can I take a completely different analogy? And that's a problem we've had recently with juries. There are 12 people who come together never knowing each other. And the temptation is, when you first become a juror, is to go look things up on the internet. And we took a quite decisive disciplinary and severe sanctions against people who were doing a voluntary service and sent people to prison for disobeying the court's order. But what we have found has been very, very effective is self-policing. And over the last couple of years, we found that once you can make people understand that actually it's fair only to make a decision against someone on the basis of the evidence that is before everyone, that innate sense of fairness, people's own views of their own ethical standards, takes over. And it's therefore inculcating, I think, through a profession, which banking is, or at least ought to be, it is getting these standards and having a shared responsibility for them, because you won't do it unless you share a belief.
Thank you, John. Now, this is a very good segue to ask Brendan Barber to... Brendan, if we can get a mic for Brendan Barber, who, as many of us know, was for many years leader of the TUC, is now chairing ACAS, which I gather doesn't involve much these days, Brendan. There's not a lot going on in the rail industry or anything, is there? No. But I know that professionalism is something that you're very interested in.
It is indeed, and it's an area where the Banking Standards Board is going to be focusing in particular over the next year, working with institutions and with the professional bodies that work with the sector. But I wanted to segue across to a slightly broader issue about the employment relations climate in the sector. And the evidence that came from the BSB's assessment and the review which we just published that showed a very high level of concern among staff in the sector about the impact of their work on their health and well-being. Over a quarter of those surveyed said they had serious concern that their working environment was in effect damaging to their well-being. And in the focus groups that lay behind, that gave some of the color to the findings from the survey, they got 28,000 responses, so a very good response rate. Some of the colour certainly painted a picture of pretty high stress environments that were causing real discomfort. Now, I guess this is an issue that's important in its own right, and the impact that it has on the effectiveness of the work that people are actually able to do in their different roles. But just to make the link across to that word trust, which is at the heart of this morning's debate. One of the big public affairs companies, Edelman, does a tracking survey year by year about the degree of trust the public have in all sorts of institutions, our political leadership, business leadership, the media, NGOs and civil society, and so on. And not surprisingly, that shows a pretty high degree of mistrust of leadership of all sorts. But one of the key factors that that survey identifies that potentially could move the dial, one of the things that really influences the level of trust people are prepared to repose in organizations, is the perception of the way in which the staff of those organizations are treated. So if we think just at the moment here in the UK, the different perceptions that perhaps people would have, say, of John Lewis compared to Sports Direct, perhaps the approach that's taken to the treatment of their staff is one of the key things that influences the level of trust. So really, I'd be interested in the panel's comments, really, on this broader employment relations climate. And what are some of the other things that perhaps we can do to begin to move that in a more positive direction?
Thank you, Brendan. Bill, have you got any thoughts you'd like to offer on this one? It was a very striking finding that came out of our report this week, this whole area.
Yeah, I saw those results, and I guess I was very interested, if you could dig down a little bit further, because, there's one thing to be stressed because you don't mind being stressed. In other words, that's what you sort of signed up for. It's another thing to be stressed, and that stress causing you to be totally alienated from your firm, your senior managers, et cetera. And I couldn't really tell from the answers to the questions exactly, was it just that people were working too long hours, and that was not so good for them? I mean, I could put my hand up. I think Mark can probably put his hand up for that when he worked in the private sector. I don't think we felt, alienated from the firms in which we were operating. So I think delving down a little deeper, exactly what's the nature of that stress? If the stress is causing people to be alienated from their firms, that's a really bad situation. And I thought one of the things I thought was interesting on the BSB survey was, you got a decent amount of responses, 30%, but I was sort of wondering what the 70% of the people that didn't respond, are they more alienated than the 30% that responded or not? And so that's sort of an interesting sort of question I have. I hope not.
Two quick points. First, one of the things that did strike me in that when I went through the report was something I mentioned up there, which is that, and I'll quote, many employees felt they came, they operated under a no mistakes environment. So again, it goes to this question of, are you, if you make a mistake, can you surface it? Does the organization deal with it fairly? Are lessons learned? Does it move on? Do you keep it pushed underground? That's the first point. The second point, which is this question of resilience, and Brendan, you know better than I, but it is one of the things that, at least this institution is thinking a lot more about, because in the end, you realize the more you dig into this, that in order to operate in these environments, unless you're like Bill and you love it and exceptionally love it, part of your job, and certainly your job as a manager, but part of your job as individuals who are operating it, is to have more of a balanced life. It does make people more effective. Yeah, it does, particularly. The more the institutions have cognitive diversity, the more collaborative decision making is made, the greater value there is to people actually having some balance to their life and being more resilient in that. So this, it becomes self-reinforcing, and the industry as a whole, including the public side of it, is way behind in that, I would say.
When people are tired, they don't make good decisions.
Yeah.
I always encourage people to take vacation. It gives you perspective. It gives you a chance of looking at the big picture.
Yeah. You get 2 weeks vacation in the U.S. Take as much as you want.
I actually get more vacation than that, thankfully.
John, did you want to?
No, I don't think I can opine on the working conditions.
Okay. The one thing I would say, though, and I'm just responding here to, I think you said something about maybe, guys in the markets are not, they work long hours. Well, yes, of course they do, but let's not forget that of the hundreds of thousands of people that work in this industry, a lot of them have got multiple domestic responsibilities,
That's fair.
You know, they've often got elderly parents who need care. They've got children that need to be all of the things that one needs to do with one's kids, pick them up from school, make sure they're cared for. So, thinking kind of, yeah, this is okay if you're working in these markets and you're making a lot of money, you can kind of handle this. Well, actually, that is not the case for most people who work in this industry. And I think what we're picking up here, Bill, is an interesting snapshot. It may well, of course, not be particular to this industry. And it may be what we're seeing is a picture of the stresses of modern life.
I do have a sort of a personal experience that there tends to be a pressure in these firms to stay as long as the last person to leave.
Yeah.
So there's this bad culture that if I actually go home, I'm somehow shirking my responsibility to myself, my peers, my firm, and that's not a great dynamic. So everyone just gets themselves totally exhausted.
Now look, time is starting to run out, so I'm just going to do a couple more. I have just spotted, while we have been talking about bankers, that sitting in the audience over there is the chairman of our biggest building society, the Nationwide. So, David Roberts. David, you've been hearing a lot of stuff about bankers this morning. Is it different in a mutual?
I think it's easier in a mutual fund. In the sense that I think trust comes from consistency of action and consistency of deed to start with. And I think secondly, it comes where there is a balance and alignment of interest. Where things go wrong quite often is when something is out of balance. So whether it be financial incentives over the duty to clients, whether it be the sense that employees are colleagues are being forced in often in implicit ways rather than explicit ways to do things that they intrinsically know are not right, but feel they have to go on. So I think in a mutual where we're owned by our members, our customers, that alignment of interest is easier to make happen. There is a problem in mutual, which is you don't have easy sources of external criticism. So you have to find it elsewhere, hence the Banking Standards Board, hence the regulators. But perhaps in this, I'd like to offer a little bit of hope, because today quite a lot of this has been about the absence of fines or the need to ensure that markets are as integral, which of course they have to be. The hope I give you is actually in technology, because if you have informed consumers, if you have a competitive market where consumers can easily make choices, if you have a ready source of access and a transparency of standards, then actually informed consumers can make good choices. And I'd put it to you that actually rebuilding trust in this industry is actually mission critical for, certainly for us, but for most, in fact all participants. Because the risk otherwise is if the brand that they stand for is perceived not to act in the interests of society and in the interests of the consumer and their clients, then I would suggest in a world of competition, in a world of where the power moves to the consumer, not the supplier, which by the way has happened and is happening ever more quickly, then actually they'll go out of business. So I think technology, the power of transparency, and the ability to take action on that actually means that regulation and the law, which is critical, actually has to be embraced. That has to be fundamentally overshadowed by ethics and integrity. Because, and therefore the question I was interested to the panel is the conduct regime here and the conduct rules have gone an awful long way in emphasising for us in 15,000 of our 18,000 colleagues that they have an onus and a duty. But actually, do they go far enough? And actually, in a profession, which I believe we are until I joined 3 or 4 years ago, should there be a duty of care explicit both to the client and to the integrity of the system?
Okay, quick question. Duty of care, would it help? Would it add? John, Do you have a thought on that? I would expect you would.
Three things. First of all, obviously transparency helps, but I think we see enough of people who think they've understood what they're being offered to realise they haven't. And I think one can overestimate putting information in front of people and letting them make a decision. I mean, the classic example of this is the modern company prospectus. Does anyone ever, other than a lawyer, ever read it? And so I think that we can, although I'm optimistic like you are, I think we need more than transparency. As to owing, imposing duties between people who are entering into a business transaction of, I'm not sure what it is, fairness, duties of obviously honesty, these need very careful thought. A lot of continental systems apparently operate on the basis you owe a duty of good faith. But actually, although we think that, that isn't how those systems operate. The good faith is a break where the continental system can't put it right. That's why I go back, actually, to what it is. When you go into a building society, like in the little Welsh village I come from when I was young, you went into the bank, you knew the bank manager, you knew he was an honest man, and it's working out how we get that into the modern home on the internet. And that, it seems to me, is fostering the culture of integrity between professionals. I don't think you'll do it any other way. I regret to say to this audience, have that much faith in the ability of the law on its own to solve these problems.
Right. Thank you, John. I'm going to stop at that point. I'm going to take one more question, and I'm going to wrap it up. I have a question in the back row.
There. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Is it working?
Nope.
Doesn't sound like it is.
Nope.
Yeah.
You're going to have to speak really loudly.
A question for the governor. You were very frank the Charles Holt in your opening remarks. I just wonder, following up on that, you mentioned particularly that the regulator must lead from the front. You also said that action, when there are transgressions in any environment, need to be proportionate. Given the severe tone of the TSC report, do you think that Charles Holt's departure was proportionate?
Well, I thought it was relatively clear in terms of was in possession of all the stuff,
as they absolutely should be. That was the determination. The TSC took a different view, and obviously the TSC's view is relevant, and fully respect that view, and it's to move on from there. And so I think the point is, what lessons are there? And we'll look at an independent review of exactly how the specifics of the situation was handled, what those judgments were, et cetera, and whether they were appropriate. But on a forward-looking basis, how we've governed our code, how we've implemented it within the institution, how we could do better, what are the broader lessons in terms of in overall governance of the institution, and then apply those. And what I was particularly trying to get across to the industry was we do not want this, and again, this is me practicing law without a license, you know, bad facts make bad law. We do not want this circumstance to ratchet the requirements for the industry. And that's not going soft on the industry, it's just being consistent with our application of the senior managers regime. And that's the core of what I was trying to get across, and hopefully that's clear.
Thank you very much, Governor. Now, we're coming to the end of this morning. Before we finish, I want to ask each of our panelists, what one thing would you like to happen now to improve the culture around this industry? Bill.
So I'm going to be very specific. I think the Banking Standards Board survey was really useful. I'd like to see it, the firms that participated here, take it to the United States and implement it there using the same set of questions. I'd like to see some of the firms that didn't participate here this time sign up for the next round here. Why do I think this is useful to do? Well, one, I think it's useful to have a benchmark. Two, I think that the BSP survey is likely to be more accurate than internal firm surveys because we've seen different results on the questions. I think the benchmark allows you to assess your performance relative to other firms, so you can't sort of delude yourself that you're doing better than maybe what you're actually doing. And it also can allow you over time to assess whether you're making progress, either absolutely or relative to other firms. So I think that this is going to be a very, very valuable tool over time, and I think we should use it as broadly as we can around the world.
Thank you. Lord Chief Justice, what would be your one thing?
Start with the young, because that's always the place you start. But start in a way that you get the chief executive to commit himself, each or herself, each year to meeting the young. The young will learn something. The chief executive will learn a great deal. And above all, it's easy to enforce through shaming those who don't do it.
We like that.
Very good. Well, I would like to see Al Niero's idea truly implemented, actually. I do think that the time is coming to, and it brings together one of Dave Roberts' point, for us to have actually a profession, a guild, a vocation, call it what you want, for wholesale markets. Now, I say wholesale markets. The reason I say that is, in part, the building blocks are being put in place, as per my previous answer. But also, you know, by some measures, 40% of global wholesale markets take place in the United Kingdom. And so this is a way to spread best practice, and it's a way to incorporate duty of care, responsibility for client, and for the system, to think longer term about the system and truly be custodians. And I think it's, you know, it's within the grasp. There's, you know, a lot of great minds and goodwill focused on these issues, and we're actually getting some momentum, so let's try to push it all the way.
Thank you. Now we're coming to the end of the morning, and I've got a number of thank yous. I'd like to thank everybody for being here today and for their engagement with these issues, which are some of the most important that we face. I'd like to thank Governor Carney for his strong support, not only for the Banking Standards Board, but for the whole set of issues around this, and for giving this such prominence in our debate. Bill, President Dudley, I would like to thank you for making time in your schedule to come to London and do this event with us today. We really appreciate it. Thank you also for your strong support of what we're all engaged on here. So thank you. And finally, Lord Chief Justice, we would like to thank you very much, John, for being here today. It's an unusual kind of event, this, where we get a chance to share thoughts with you and see you in this context, and we're extremely grateful to you. And I'd like to say one further thing about the Lord Chief Justice, who, as everybody will know, is approaching the end of his tenure as Lord Chief Justice. So, John, although the end of your tenure has not yet arrived, this seems to be a very good moment to thank you on behalf of everybody in the room for your service to our country. John, thank you. Thanks everyone for coming. I believe and hope that there is some excellent Bank of England tea and coffee outside, but I could be wrong.
I hope so.
I always like to take notes.
Bill has left his stuff. So I will have to go back to Mark's room. You can get Robin over to the room. Hello.